Shropshire last year, which is really quite a great disappointment, because I was hoping to join in celebrations for the achievements in the Millennium Development Goals. It's easy to undermine what a magnificent achievement this activity has been. But for those of us who can think back to 2015, 2000 with the ambition for 2015, and the challenges it represents, can think back to the earlier challenges that the global community set itself, one can't help but be impressed at the magnificent progress that has taken place over those 15 years. And I'm delighted to see that the people who have been instrumental in making that happen, part of them, many of them are in this room, and I congratulate you very warmly on that singular achievement. Of course, the difficulty in being successful is that they give you a bigger challenge next time, and the bigger challenge will come, but I think you're in a much better position to take that on than you were 15 years ago, and I have no doubt that you have it within your capability and capacity to address those problems in an appropriate way. It's delightful to be able to listen to the Director General of the United Nations recognize the reduction in poverty, the decline in hunger, the improvement in child and mortality, but the recognition that much more needs to be done. And it's important to reflect upon what it is that we need to do in order to enable that more. And the two things that I thought were really important was that lack of data hampers effective policy making. Whose job is it to collect good quality data that informs our process? Our job. Sustainable data are needed for sustainable development. So there's our job set out for us. The only question we have is, how best do we organize ourselves to go about it to ensure that we can achieve it? Well, we know that we can do it, because if we simply take severe malnutrition, I mean, I've been involved in this area for many years, and I know that the change over the last 15 years, first of all, in the approach to treating severe malnourished children in hospital, and then the extension of that understanding into the community, using a simple but effective magic bullet in the form of ready-to-use therapeutic foods, with simple screening that we've been using for half a decade, organized, put together properly, saves lives, makes a difference. So if there are people around who are unsure about whether or not nutrition can make an immediate and tangible difference, please go and look at the management and care of severely malnourished children, who in a matter of hours and days are transformed from a horrible future into great hope. So there's no uncertainty that there are ways of doing things, and that we can, when enabled, skilled, and organized, make those things happen. I'm very pleased that the International Union of Nutritional Sciences has played its role, not least through enabling the International Task Force of Malnutrition, which was formed by the IUNS with the International Pediatric Association in 2005, and which has a board with agencies and NGOs which have provide oversight for its activities. And there's no doubt that we have played a role in helping and facilitating providing a technical support to that activity. Not a membership organization, we're already members of the IUNS. It is a group of people who choose to work together to pool their skills, capabilities, and resources to make things better. In the recognition clearly that all patients, not just some patients, but all patients need to receive adequate nutrition. And that's about an amount of quality. It's not just some days, it's every day. And that if we fail to do that, then there is vulnerability. Risk in the short term of acute and chronic ill health, there are costs to the individual and society, and greater disadvantage and poor quality of life. And clearly this is central to the opportunities for development. If we don't address this, then we cannot healthier diets support better nutrition, and this works from the normal molecular and cellular level through tissues right up to the whole body. So the system as a whole is a better system in that context, and we can measure that without any uncertainty in infancy and childhood through observing normal growth and development, and at all ages by assessing and knowing that the individual is capable of protecting themselves against environmental challenge through appropriate immune inflammatory repair processes. This is classical nutrition. It's not a matter of debate. We know that for sure. And we know, as this morning Andrew showed us in pictures, to frighten us into the concerns of where the world is going, and that nutrition sits at the heart of that. Well, you can look at that in two ways. For those who were alive 50 years ago, the threats to the world were of a much different order to those that they are now. For those who were concerned at the pre-revolution, we were never going to get here, but we have got here now. And I have no doubt that we have the capability of addressing these, but that capability of addressing these means that we have to recognize the critical, fundamental, and central role that nutrition plays. And if we ask ourselves whether or not we are organized, have the capability to do this at a sufficient level, the answer is simply no. We simply don't have enough of the right people doing the right things in the right way, in the right place, to address these major issues. So there's a job to be done about people. And really what I want to talk about is people. And I go back to the comment about lessons from the Caribbean, because it caused me to reflect that when we last looked at it, the health gains per dollar spent, there is an international league table, and I was very pleased to see that the health gains per dollar spent, two of the top five countries in the world were in the Caribbean, and one of those was Jamaica. Now, Jamaica doesn't have much money, and you have to say, well, how on earth did it achieve that? And I think it achieved it because its people, the African diasporic people who survived the Middle Passages and learned some hard lessons in life, managed to organize themselves in a way to address their problems for survival in a way that didn't depend upon money coming in from other places. They did it for themselves because they wanted to and they had to. Clearly, there are different forms of evidence, and over the last little while, we've become increasingly concerned about a particular kind of evidence to inform policy and to enable choices to be made to enable change. And the nature and the application of evidence is really very important. And I've been involved in this for quite some time. I was chairman of the UK Government Advisory Committee on this for many years, 10 years or so. Important role in assessing the evidence for salt, which caused the government to change the approach to salt, and more recently in terms of carbohydrates and so on and so forth. But one of the very early observations of that committee, when we made, reported to the chair of the Food Standards Agency, Sir John Krebs, now Lord Krebs, anybody who's done biochemistry knows about his lineage, but most of that was based upon an assessment of biomedical evidence. But the policy concerns went far beyond the biomedical evidence that we collected and also involved social, behavioral, and environmental considerations. And we were no good at collecting that information together in a systematic and structured way, in the same way as we could with the biomedical evidence. And we weren't that sure that the people who were skilled in that area were able to do it in a way that adequately represented what we were looking for. And I was concerned and troubled by this for quite a long time. And I remember Tola Tina sitting in the front row. There was a few years ago, we had a meeting in Nigeria where we did a workshop on nutritional training and the graduate level for Basma were party to that. And we had a group of students, and because we had to spend time setting up, we had a conversation. And one of the first questions that I was asked was, are you going to focus on a human rights approach to managing severe malnutrition? Well, I had no idea what this young lady was talking about, but I, being a professor, away and discovered that the question that she was asking is in fact the question that I had been struggling with for some time. And it's a question that had already been addressed by my old friend, Irvin Johnson. And I'd simply like to recognize the passing of Irvin this year. I had hoped that he would be at this meeting to speak himself, but unfortunately